Welcome, everyone. My name is Diego Rodriguez Pinzon. I'm a co-director of the Academy of Human Rights and Humanitarian Law in the Washington College of Law, American University. And I'm here also with a dual role. I have another hat, which member of the American Society of International Law. We have been asked with my colleague, Carlos Martin, to introduce you to this event. Some of the representatives couldn't be here, so let me first talk in the name of the society, ACIL, to invite you. You know, this is a membership organization, very prestigious, not only with a broad membership in the US, but beyond, and we can talk about that because many of our friends in Latin America, in Europe and beyond, are indeed members of the society. So it's a fascinating opportunity for those that are interested in searching and looking for more information about ACIL. You can go downstairs after the event and you'll find and gather some information that could be useful for getting additional information of what the organization does. My second role, dual, as co-director of the Academy on Human Rights, we have been hosting for now, I think, 4 years with the American Society of International Law this event during this month in June. It's part of the Human Rights Month series of our institution. The Academy hosts a summer program, and within the program, we have a series of panels, both at the Washington College of Law and here in ACIL, in which we are able to bring very distinguished panelists to discuss several issues in international law and international humanitarian law. So as part of those series, we are here convening what is going to be the last event of this year's series here at ACIL. And again, to invite you to visit us in our website and see what we are hosting throughout the year. And of course, next summer, hopefully we'll have many of the distinguished panelists here and many more that we have as faculty in our law school during this month. Hopefully you will join us. I'm going to leave you then with Professor Douglas Caso, that is joined by two other distinguished panelists he was going to present. The three of them are faculty right now in the Academy on Human Rights and Humanitarian Law, and it's a privilege for us to count with your presence. So I'll leave you in the hands of Professor Douglas Caso.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Diego, and thank you all for coming out this evening. Along with our two principal speakers this evening, I'm sure that we're all pleased to be a member of the American University Mafia. My own law school dean would probably consider it treason if I didn't also mention that I teach at the University of Notre Dame near Chicago, and some of our alumni are here this evening. As you know, we're here to listen to two expert speakers assessing some of the pros and cons that we've learned from 20 years of experience with international criminal tribunals. For those of us of a certain age, it's possible to remember that a little more than 20 years ago, this evening would have been impossible. The building was here, but there was no such thing as international criminal tribunals. By 1992, there had not been an international criminal court since Nuremberg and Tokyo nearly a half century earlier, and there were a great many wise people in the field of international law who thought there wouldn't be one. But in 1993, the UN Security Council established by resolution the International Criminal Tribunal for Yugoslavia. A year later, the Tribunal for Rwanda. A few years later, in 1998, the negotiators in Rome agreed to establish the International Criminal Court, whose treaty came into force and the court came into being in 2002. So we've had a sea change in the enforcement of international criminal law with regard to human rights and humanitarian law in only the space of two decades. And this may be, therefore, a good opportunity to take a look at what is the status of international criminal tribunals, how are they doing, what do they achieve, what can they realistically achieve. But this is an old debate. When the creation of the international tribunals was being discussed in the early 1990s, there were basically, by my estimation, three schools of thought. There were the skeptics. They told us that international criminal tribunals could never work. Nuremberg only worked because Germany lost the war and the Western powers had conquered them. The same thing with Tokyo. There would be no way for the international tribunals to arrest their suspects, no way for them to gather evidence, no way for them to gain legitimacy at the national level. They were doomed to fail, we were told. Then a second school of thought were the enthusiasts. International criminal tribunals would end impunity for atrocities. They would deter crimes against humanity. They would make clear the world would no longer tolerate man's, well, I guess I could say women's, but it's mostly man's inhumanity to man. And then there was a third camp of people who were cautious, who suggested that international criminal tribunals would be feasible in some circumstances. They could serve as a useful tool in particular cases and would be capable at times of dispensing exemplary justice. Now, what have the two decades since then taught us about which camp was correct? Our speakers will address that, but just a couple of preliminary points to get us started. First of all, the ICTY is now, technically speaking, 22 years old. It was established in 1993. It rendered its first judgment in 1997, I believe, in the Tadic case. It is now trying its last four cases and its last 10 appeals. Over the course of these years, the ICTY has indicted 161 individuals. Half of those, 80, have had their cases taken to trial and reached final judgments of guilty. Another 18 have been found after trial to be not guilty. Other cases had their indictments withdrawn or were transferred to national courts. Along the way, the Yugoslavia Tribunal has prosecuted a number of big fish. Mr. Milosevic, who of course was the president of the former Federal Republic of Yugoslavia, who unfortunately died while his trial was underway, and the political and military leaders of the Bosnian Serbs, Republika Srpska, Mr. Karadzic and Mr. Mladic, are currently on trial in The Hague. What can we make of the Yugoslavia Tribunal with this kind of data? Well, we'll hear more from Judge Pokar on that, but I wonder whether you might conclude, Judge Pokar, that the Yugoslavia Tribunal shows that in given circumstances, international criminal tribunals can work, but slowly and at great financial cost. The International Criminal Court was established 5 years later in 1998, came into force in 2002. It now has 123 states parties. Compare that to the total UN membership of 193, so it's about two-thirds of the UN member states. It does not, however, include a number of the big powers, including the United States, China, Russia, India, Indonesia, and another 60 or so countries. Since it came into operation in 2002, the ICC has had 22 cases in 9 situations, and all 9 of those situations are in Africa. It also, in addition to those 22 cases in 9 situations, has 7 situations under preliminary examination, of which 2 are in Africa and the others are in other parts of the world. If I'm right, Judge Steiner, the ICC has reached, I believe, 3 final verdicts.
Two
of guilty and 1 of not guilty.
Yeah, three.
It currently has, by my count, 9 individuals in custody in The Hague, and another 4 who were under interim release, having previously been in custody. Of its defendants, 4 of them have been heads of state or former heads of state and government, one of whom died before he could be tried, one of whose cases was dismissed, one of whom is at large, and one of whom, Mr. Bagbo from Cote d'Ivoire, is in custody. So I wonder, Judge Steiner, if we might conclude that the ICC's record to date has been relatively small in terms of direct production, but perhaps has had a larger impact in terms of stimulating national laws that codify international crimes, and perhaps to stimulate national prosecutions, and perhaps by its very existence to deter. To give you the definitive answers to these questions, we could not have two more qualified speakers than our presenters this evening. Our first speaker will be Judge Sylvia Steiner from Brazil. She has been a judge on the International Criminal Court since 2003. Now, for those of you who have memorized the ICC statute, you know that that's impossible because it's only a 9-year term and therefore she should have been sent home in 2012. But there's also a rule that says if you're sitting on a case and it's not over yet, you stay there until you've finished the case. So she is still sitting on the Bemba case from the Central African Republic. And that case is now under deliberation by the judges and expected, I believe, to conclude sometime this year. Before joining the International Criminal Court, Judge Steiner was a federal public prosecutor in Sao Paulo in the early 1980s. She later served on the Penitentiary Council of Sao Paulo in the 80s and 90s. She was a federal court of appeals judge in Brazil from 1995 to 2003, and she was a member of the Brazilian delegation to the ICC PrepCom from 1999 to 2002. After Judge Steiner speaks, we will then pass the microphone to Judge Fausto Pocar of Italy. He has been a judge of the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia since 1999. He was president of the tribunal from 2005 to 2008 and vice president from 2003 to 2005. Because the ICTY and the ICTR share a common appeals chamber, he is also able to be a judge of the appeals chamber of the International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda, which he has been, I believe, since the year 2000. And before serving as a judge on the ICTY and the ICTR, he was a member of the United Nations Human Rights Committee for quite a period of time, from 1984 to the year 2000, and served as chair of that committee in 1991 and 1992. And he is also a professor of international law at the University of Milan. So without further ado, thank you all for joining us. Thank you especially to our two speakers. And after they conclude, of course, we will open the floor to your thoughts, your questions, and your inputs. Judge Steiner.
Good afternoon. I welcome all those that are here present. I welcome my dear Professor Kassel, my dear friend, Professor Fausto Pocar, and once again, thanking the invitation to be here present today in order to participate in this debate about international criminal courts at Crossroad. I belong to the second group, Professor Castle. I'm among the optimistics. I do believe that international criminal courts play an important, a very important role in fighting impunity around the world. I do believe that the creation of the two ad hoc tribunals brought to the international community or represented to the international community a big advance in terms of creating a unique jurisprudence. And I do believe that the creation of the International Criminal Court as the first permanent criminal court in the international scenario means the second big advance since Nuremberg. I consider, however, and I'm going to try to situate my feelings in relation to my court, to the ICC, of course subject to the criticisms that for sure will come. But starting by saying that although the Rome Statute entered into force in 2002, the court itself started working or being operational only in 2006, when the first case, the Uganda case, started. So the ICC is still a baby. If we compare with the judicial system, national systems, when you have already a jurisprudence or the experience and the methodology to how to conduct a case is one thing. When you talk about a court that has been just inaugurated about less than 10 years ago, I think it's understandable the difficulties faced by the ICC since its beginning. First, because of its proceedings. The ICC, the Rome Statute provides by a procedure that is pretty different than the system that is applied by the ad hoc tribunals. So the whole system of proceedings had to be created from scratch, as from 2006, and when the first cases started arriving at the court. The second point in relation to the ICC, it is its character of complementarity. Is a court that can only react can when the state that has jurisdiction over a certain situation or a certain case remains inactive. So this is the first barrier that the ICC has to confront. The ICC, as Professor Castle said, has today 123 states parties. But its jurisdiction is quite limited in time, for instance, because jurisdiction can only be activated for crimes committed after 2002, when the Rome Statute entered into force, or for the states that ratified later, after the ratification by those states. So there is this limitation based on complementarity. There is the limitation, the temporal limitation. There is a limitation on jurisdiction in relation to the territorial requirement. The ICC can only exercise jurisdiction over crimes committed in territory of states parties or by nationals of states parties. So there are a series of barriers till a case can finally arrive at the ICC for its examination by the judges. With all these difficulties, I can repeat what was said by Professor Castle. We have, since the beginning of the functioning of the ICC, we opened nine situations. From these nine situations, we have initiated proceedings in 21 cases against 36 suspects. So I think for a baby court, as I used to say, the results are not so negative. I think the results can be considered as quite significant. And the ICC faces another big problem, because it's a court created not by a resolution of the Security Council, but rather by a treaty. It subjects the states that ratify the treaty to the obligation of cooperate with the court. The states that are not states parties have no obligation at all to cooperate with the court. And even many states parties refuse to cooperate with the court. The court has no police. The court cannot enforce its own decisions. The court depends 100% on the cooperation of states. Just to give you an idea from the situations, the nine situations that are currently before the court, two situations were referred to the court by the Security Council, which is one of the possibilities of activate the jurisdiction of the court. The cases of Libya and the case of Sudan. Even in this, these situations referred to the court by the Security Council, the states, non-parties, gave no any kind of cooperation with the court, including the states that referred, the states, non-parties, that referred the case to the ICC. So Security Council referred two cases to the ICC, and in the resolution itself, it says that the United Nations will not cooperate, financially cooperate in any way with the court. The court has a limited budget. So two cases that arrive, and from the magnitude of cases related to the situations of crisis in Libya and in Darfur, and receiving not only financial cooperation from the United Nations, any kind of cooperation. The resolutions of the Security Council, they invite the states to cooperate with the court. So we, just to give you an idea that the court sometimes is seen as playing an important role in reestablishing peace and in fighting against impunity, and at the same time, the same states that ratified the statute or the Security Council referring important cases to the court refuse to give the court the proper assistance in order for the court to comply with its duties, starting by the arrest of the suspect. So I don't have anything really original to say here, because I presume that this kind of information is of public knowledge. In the website of the court, you can follow the cases that are open, the cases that have been already tried, the cases that are still under investigation, the situations that are under preliminary examination by the prosecution. But it was a coincidence that very recently it came to my attention an article written by Professor Daryl Robinson. The was published in the Leiden Journal of International Law. It's a very, very important journal on international law. And Professor Daryl Robinson participated since the beginning of the creation of the International Criminal Court, the first discussions in the preparation of the Rome Conference. And the Professor Robinson's article has a title, Inescapable Diads, Why the International Criminal Court Cannot Win. And I went through the article many times, and of course I'm not going to read the whole article, but I can leave then the reference that for you to consult this article in the website of the Leiden University. But there are some points raised by Professor Robinson that I think are very important to be noted in this discussion of ours. Professor Robinson notes that more recently the critical note against the ICC come to dominate the discourse. Today, journal articles, blogs, postings, and everything in every media, possible media, feature a variety of increasingly strident criticism of the court. For example, he mentions criticism that the court, the decisions of the court, are political. But this term is used to advance opposing criticisms. And then he goes throughout the article to show that no matter what the court does or doesn't, the same criticisms will come to light. And sometimes from the same critics, which is more interesting. And that's why, and I would like to repeat here, and I'm giving the source, it's not a plagiarism, it's just because I think it was brilliant when Professor Robinson mentions or says in his article, consider for a moment the popular folk tale Goldilocks and the Three Bears. It offers a recurring pattern wherein one bowl of porridge is too hot, the next is too cold, and the third is just right. Similarly, one bed is too hard, the next is too soft, and the third just right. He mentions this dialectical three, where the first is wrong in one way, the second in another or opposite way, and only the third in the middle is just right. Highlighting then the important theme of finding an exact middle path between opposites. And then proceeds Professor Robinson. As one reads the literature on the activities of the ICC, situation selection, case selection, trigger mechanisms, cooperation, and so on, a recurring lament is that the ICC keeps failing to get its metaphorical porridge just right. This repeated failure on the part of the court officials is commonly ascribed to short-sightedness, incompetence, politicization, or naivety. And here it comes. However, what I will suggest is that on many issues facing the ICC, there is simply no such thing as just right. There is no position that cannot plausibly be criticized as either too hot or too cold. Indeed, many positions can be credibly criticized as both too hot and too cold, which may sound paradoxical, but it is not. And then proceeds Professor Robinson to demonstrate by way of many examples, and I'm not going, I repeat, to take your time just to repeating what was said here, that the most important point is that there is no magic in between that is safe from any kind of criticisms. And this in any legal system. Judiciary is one of the organs or the powers, depending on how you interpret the position of the judiciary, that never satisfies 100% of its consumers. Always 50% will be unhappy. Those that lose the case, those that are found guilty, or the prosecution when someone is found not guilty, etc. Professor Robinson mentions one situation that I can testify, because it was a situation that occurred before the chamber I was in. It was a pretrial chamber when received the request of the prosecution for the issuance of an order of arrest against President al-Bashir. Is a catch-22 situation. If you issue the warrant of arrest, it's because the court is trying to appear, to get some high-profile accused, and to show its independence, and so these were the sort of criticisms. If the court does not issue the warrant of arrest, the court is protecting the powerful, the court is not paying attention to the poor victims, the court is not achieving its goals or to put an end to impunity, etc., etc. And as a judge, I remember so well that period. not direct pressures, never happened, but of course a generalized pressure from the media, the televisions, the newspapers. And I remember so well the judges in a deliberation room saying, you know, we should spend some time now not reading these newspapers, not watching TV. Let's go to just examine the documents the prosecutor brought to us. Forget that we are dealing with the head of state. Pretend it's Mr. X, and whether there are the requisites for the issuance of a warrant of arrest are present or not. That was the decision taken by the judges in order to ensure its impartiality. And that decision was subject to many criticisms as well, because judges cannot be isolated in a castle. They need to look around. They need to think of the consequences of the decisions they take, etc., etc. So again, a no-win situation. Nowadays, in relation to the situation the preliminary examination in Palestine, the same. We don't know, the judges, we have no idea what is going to be the reaction of the office of the prosecution to the request of Palestine for the opening of a preliminary examination or for the opening of an investigation. But we can anticipate that again is a catch-22 scenario, that in order to prove impartiality, the prosecution may have to compromise his impartiality. So this points to the tension, the constant tension of appearing impartial and being impartial. And this leads to the dyad of independence. The court needs to be independent at the same time as the court is 100% dependent on states, because the court cannot react to any situation without states' cooperation. So I tried just to point out to these observations made in a very, very interesting, much deeper article in which different issues are brought to light, in order to show that the criticism against the ICC, its functioning, the criteria for the selection of the cases or the way the cases are conducted, or for instance today in class in the morning, students criticizing the court because the two sentences applied till now were too lenient against Mr. Lubanga and against Mr. Katanga. That shows that is an institution, first, in my view, that starts bothering a lot of people, which is very good. It's being discussed by scholars, by students, by governments, by the Security Council, by countries that support the court, and by countries that not support the court, which is very good in my point of view. And objectively speaking, having, after 7 or 8 years of effective functioning, 36 cases ongoing, I think it's not a bad result. This is just the beginning. So I'm continue to be the same optimistic I was in 99, 2000, 2001, when I was participating at the preparatory commission of the rules of procedure and evidence and elements of crimes. And I'm let's say, not that I don't give so much importance for the criticism. I think we need, because there is a lot to be improved. There is still a lot that can be improved in the functioning of the court. We started already. We are doing in an ongoing exercise of learning lessons in order to try to improve proceedings, to make the proceedings shorter than they are, to replace the need of constant presence of witnesses and replace that by testimonies, by way electronic ways, video link, etc., in order to ensure that we can get the evidence we need during trial without having, as we had in the Bemba case, to wait for 2 months for one of the witness to come, because the poor man had no documents, so could not have passport, so could not have a visa for traveling to The Hague. And so we have this ongoing exercise of lessons learned, which means that we assume that we have to improve. On the other hand, I think this constant and repetitive behavior on criticize, no matter what you do, I think sometimes it's more convenient than really analyze the causes of the failure in a certain point, and it's much easier speech than the justification one. So I continue, Professor Castle, in the second group, and I'm very proud of that. So thank you for your patience, and I will finish now, and later, if need be, I'm open for answer any questions that you have. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Judge Steiner. That's a ringing testimonial from the only remaining judge of the first group of judges to sit on the ICC. Just as a informational point, we might come back to it later, the two sentences that you referred to as receiving some criticism for being too light, I believe one was for 14 years and the other was for 12 years, but we can perhaps talk about that later. Judge Pocat?
Thank you. First, let me say how happy I am to be here again, this time under the direction of Professor Castle, and to again participate in this program of the American University and American Society together, and to last but not least, to cross again our swords with Judge Steiner. It's not the first time, I think it's the third time we are together, not always alone. Once we had Judge Cansado Trindade with us, but it's a recurrent event. I'm frequently criticized because I criticize by my colleague Sylvia Steiner, that says I'm always criticizing what she says. And she likes to be first always, because then she can answer my criticism. But have a presentation that, as you have seen, vigorously supports the court. Anyway, I must say I admire her to be so optimistic, because being optimistic, notwithstanding events, criticism, is a good thing. I mean, one shows one is on a line and does not change the line. If I take the the three positions expressed by Professor Kassel at the beginning, I can't say honestly that I was in one category and I remain in the same category. My initial approach was to be among the skeptics. When the ICTY was created, I had a feeling it will not work. As many said at the time, I didn't see how it would work. I had the feeling that the Security Council established it because there were these reports from Yugoslavia, later Rwanda, and had to do something. I mean, as you know, especially for Rwanda, the day after, the United Nations were very much implicated in what happened, in what they didn't do in order that it didn't happen. Kofi Annan recognized it later very, very honestly. And the Security Council felt it had to do something. But whether they decided, feeling that it would succeed, I didn't think so. They decided to do it because they had to do something. But that they wanted it to succeed, I'm not even sure. I'm not even sure. For some, could have been an alibi to say, we did. Then it doesn't work, it's not our fault. But we intervened. We did something. Then I was offered to go to the tribunal. It was very much hesitating to accept. There was insistence by my government because the first time I replaced my compatriot, Judge Cassese, who resigned during the term, a term. In this case, the statute provides for the replacement being made by the Secretary General, not through an election, until the end of the term of the predecessor of the judge resigning. And you may imagine, you study international law, that when in a position there is an election by the General Assembly and the Secretary General has to make a replacement, he will not disturb the election, in principle, unless he has to do it. He will look for somebody that will keep the election as it was, so somebody of the same nationality, essentially. Only if the country concerned does not want to propose anybody, the Secretary General will look elsewhere, inevitably, because he has to do it. And it happened once, it happened with Canada, because the Canadian judge resigned in 1999, I think, and Canada did not propose anybody else. Did not propose anybody else because at the time Canada got the prosecutor of the ICTY, so couldn't have both, and so decided not to not to insist in having also a judge. At the time, was a good time for the tribunal because the ICT, the Secretary General chose Judge Shahabuddin from Guyana, who was an excellent lawyer, an excellent jurist. So the tribunal benefited from that decision of the Secretary General. But when I accepted and went to the tribunal with some skepticism, after some time I started changing my view, my skeptical view. Not to become optimistic, like my colleague Judge Steiner on international justice, but at least in the third category. Those who felt that international justice in certain circumstances could work, could do something at least. And I did my best to try to do something. I am now, I think, the most senior criminal judge in any court, international court. That's still in a court. All the other judges, the ICCC, of course, started later, and all the other judges of the ICTY or CTR have less seniority than me. So I participated in all the events for long part of the events of the ICTY and of the ICTR, with a total, I never calculated it, must be at least 30 or 35 judgments in which I participated, many of them I presided. So I have inevitably some experience of what happened, which does not bring me to be optimistic, I must say, but that it can work in certain circumstances, which corresponds, in my view, to the development of what happened in the world when the adventure of establishing an international court with the ICTY started. And let me take two aspects. First, my tribunal, or my tribunals, because in fact I'm a member of both, the ICTY and the ICTR, and the other more general on international justice, which I think also the theme of this debate suggests, to see more in general international justice. As to the ICTY, it started well, notwithstanding that, as I said, I'm not sure that those who established it wanted it to work. But they put a number of persons in that tribunal that were optimistic, clearly optimistic, maybe utopists also. Optimism and utopism go frequently together. And decided to have it work. Judge Cassese, Judge Abisab, other of that time, decided to have it work. And made it work. De facto made it work. Succeeded in establishing rules of procedure and evidence that were not provided for by the Security Council. Had some indictment going out. Justice Goldstone from South Africa issued some important indictment, including Mladic, including Karadzic. The indictment went out very, very quickly. The cooperation of the states of the region was inexistent, of course, as it is well known. But then a first person was arrested. Was arrested because the statute provided for the priority of the jurisdiction of the tribunal over domestic jurisdiction. And Tadic was arrested in Germany and was going to be tried by a German court. The tribunal asked to send him to The Hague. And of course, Germany cooperated with the tribunal, obviously. It was not a country of the region, and sent Tadic to the court. And this allowed to have one case, not of a big fish, but a case where the tribunal did the most important things, in my view, because it solicited a prodigious progress in the law. And that's the main achievement, I think, of the history of the ICTY. Both criminal law, but in general, international law, humanitarian law. The decision of the appeals chamber on jurisdiction of Tadic changed the law, changed humanitarian law, changed customary law today, was the basis of changing the scope of application of the Geneva Conventions. The Geneva Conventions apply essentially only to international conflicts. Modern conflicts are mostly domestic. And the system of the Geneva Convention and the protocols of 77 does not provide for an obligation to criminalize the violations of the convention for internal conflicts. Because the Geneva Conventions provide for a system of grave breaches of the convention, for which states are obliged to prosecute under a principle of universal jurisdiction, the cases, and are not obliged for the violations that are not grave breaches. But as to domestic conflicts, there are no grave breaches. The second protocol of 77 does not provide for the system of grave breaches. And Tadic uses the tribunal in Tadic uses the common sense, decided that the same regime, in fact, applied also to domestic conflicts. It was a great, great leap forward that was done. But even states, the few years before, when the second protocol was discussed, refused to accept the proposal coming from some countries to establish a regime of grave breaches in domestic conflicts, did not, even these states did not protest, did not react. And the fact is that the regime now of international criminal law includes also domestic conflicts. The statute of the ICC includes the domestic conflicts. Keeps the distinction between international and domestic conflicts, probably because it's wanted to link it to Geneva Conventions. The adoption of the statute is 98, was too early to apply the Tadic rule, probably when it was negotiated, so the regime remains, but it's a bit anachronistic today. Also in the statute of the ICC, because de facto, the crimes, the behavior that constitute a crime in international conflicts are crimes in domestic conflicts. And this is just a big achievement in international law that the states had not been able to do, actually. It was created by a court. This is just one example. But later, all the explanation and clarification of international law, of international criminal law, was made essentially by the ICTY and the ICTR. All the progress in the consideration of gender crimes, it did not exist before. War crimes did not include gender crimes. In the Geneva Convention, there is nothing about that. There is simply nothing. Now, if you look at the situation now, the law is clear. International law is clear, or relatively clear. I'm not saying it could not progress and be even better, but it exists. It's there. The ICTR in the Akayesu case decided that rape can be a means of genocide. This is not in the Convention on Genocide. You had to interpret very progressively the Convention on Genocide to insert this. It was done. It was done by the trial chamber in the Akayesu case, and Judge Pillay was one of those who pushed for that solution. Judge Pillay later became a judge of the ICC and later the High Commissioner of Human Rights. So South African, they did a lot in human rights. And the appeal chamber, I sat in the Akayesu case on appeal, didn't touch the point. Instead, confirmed, simply, without discussing the issue, said it was a good solution. But there are other cases in which the ICTY progressed, the Kunaraj case in 2001, and so on. And what is interesting is that the ICTY did all these things on the law quickly, very quickly. The ICTY was established in 93, end of 93. And all this case law came out in 10 years. In 10 years was done. So in 10 years, around, I don't have the figures, but around 10 appeal cases had already come out. So must be a dozen or more of trials had been concluded. So it's a huge work that was done in a very short time. And this was very, very effective. This pushed me to say it could It could work. It can work. Now, I'm not skeptic, but I am definitely in this other category because the recent case law of the ICTY, instead of progressing, shows steps backwards or difficulties, political difficulties, states that cooperate less, it's also a possibility, not in the region, because in the region they cooperate more, of course, but outside, less interest of the international community to have a progress in this matter. It's like if those who were against at the time or established the tribunals like alibis for their conscience, seeing that it went progress too much, say, well, now it's time to go down and not have it to go too much, an independent judiciary. So let's force a bit judiciary. And my fear is that this affects the ICC. It's not the ICC the responsible, not the judges. Prosecutor, I would make a distinction between judges and prosecutor. Because judges, after all, depend on the prosecutor. If the prosecutorial policy is good, judges have the good cases. If the prosecutorial policy is bad, they have bad cases. So the responsibility of the prosecutor is huge. And if the prosecutor wants just to appear, the cases are not the good ones. If it makes a good prosecutorial policy, the situation is totally different. I don't want now to criticize necessarily the prosecutors, but they have a great responsibility. And I don't minimize the neither the responsibility nor the difficulty of the job of the prosecutor, because clearly the prosecutors is more subjected to pressure by political instances, inevitably. Judges are less. It's easier for a judge to be independent than for the prosecutor. That's quite clear. But certainly the prosecutors went frequently in every tribunal too much sometimes in the sense of taking into account political considerations. I don't explain why in the ICTY there was an indictment against Milosevic and there was no indictment against the president of Croatia, against the president of Bosnia. When NGOs have prepared volumes on those cases, was that a political approach of the prosecutor? I don't know. Maybe not. Maybe the prosecutor didn't have the evidence. Didn't have the investigation, didn't bring the evidence. That's also possible. I recognize this, but the perception might be a perception that is not exact. Changes in the case law that resulted in acquittals of high levels are all due to the dossier that the judges have to examine or depend on other considerations. Cases that result in acquittal because the prosecutor is not bringing the evidence. Was the prosecutor willing to lose the case? But at the same time, give the impression he went in all directions? I don't know, he or she, because prosecutors frequently have been women. So we have to consider that there was no discrimination in the choice of the prosecutors before in the ICTY or ICTR. Now, This is for the ICTY. More in general, I feel that we are at a turning point. I think the situation is not easy for international justice now. The growth of international justice has depended on a proliferation of courts. Each of them has different features. Only the ICTY and the ICTR have the same features. Of all the courts, 10 courts have been established. Because the two are linked, are both decided by the Security Council. The two status are homogeneous. The case law is more or less coherent because the appeals chamber is the same, has the same composition. So at the end, you reach a jurisprudence which is consistent. But the other courts have different features. The ICC was established by a treaty. A treaty should show more commitment of states, in theory. The practice has shown that's not true. Judge Steiner has explained that states, even states, parties do not cooperate frequently with the court. So a tribunal established by the Security Council is universal in a way, not as to jurisdiction, the geographical jurisdiction, but as a court, as is universal court, because it's established by the Security Council, by the UN. So it answers to the UN, is accountable to the UN, is universal for the limits of its jurisdiction, in that sense universal. A treaty-based body is not universal, unless all the states accept it, which is far, far away as a possible development, because two-thirds of the international community accepted it, more or less. Roughly. But if you look at the population protected, it's less than 50%. It's around 40% maximum of the population of the world protected by the court. Because the states have not ratified, have a huge population. And if one calculates that, we are far below 50% of the international population of the world, of the population of the world. So it's the universality is far to be far from being at hand. And as to the other courts, the international community has gone through agreements with the states, so with Cambodia, with Sierra Leone, with East Timor, with Lebanon, establishing courts as a hybrid composed of judges appointed internationally, inserting this system of this court as special courts at the domestic level. Not all of them are really international courts. The Cambodian court is not international, it's part of the judiciary of Cambodia. It's the Sierra Leone court was part of the judiciary of Sierra Leone, in technically speaking. But the judges were in part appointed externally, in part domestic judges. The law applicable is at the same time international law and domestic law, and domestic criminal law. So this shows that the strategy of the international community, no strategy existed. There has been this proliferation, but nobody had a clear idea where to go. And that makes the problem now very, very critical, because the scenario is changing. In a few years, all these courts close. The ICTR will close this year. There is one case on appeal, which I presided. But in November we will issue it, the decision, and then it's closed. Does not exist anymore. The ICTY has more cases, but they will close. A couple of years will be finished and closed. The Sierra Leonean court has already closed. The Cambodian court has one case, will go on a bit, but then will close. And other courts will close. We are facing a scenario in a few years in which it's like having a theater where you have a big drama, a dramatic event with many protagonists, many people, many actors. And then a certain moment, you open the curtain during the play, and there is one participant. Will that participant be able to stage the entire play or not? That's the issue. And I'm not criticizing the ICC at all. I don't want to criticize the ICC because it doesn't make sense. The fact is that in a few years, we will have only the ICC. That's the issue. And if you have only one instrument, you have to make it work. It's the same reasoning with the United Nations. How many people criticize the United Nations because they don't work? They are not effective? Any of you have heard this criticism, say, against the United Nations. But what do we have to keep the international community together? The United Nations. So this kind of criticism doesn't make sense. The important thing is to have the instrument to work. And if we will have a situation with the ICC only, we have to make the ICC work and be effective. That's the point. It's not a question of being optimistic. It's realism, in my view. That's what has to be done. Is a necessity to work on. Or if you think it doesn't work at all, you set it aside and do something else. But what else? I think it's easier to make the ICC work, not necessarily as a perfect body, but to have it work seriously and efficiently than to invent something else. Some reform may be necessary. I think that the procedure, the rules of procedure of the ICC do not work. And part of the responsibility of the states, because unlike in the ICTY, where the Security Council said, you, court, decide your rules of procedure and evidence. The states party decided on the rules of procedure and evidence. And don't criticize that. But once you do, that's finished. Your role is finished. It should not be that any small change in the procedure depends on a decision of the Assembly of States Parties, depends on a political approach to this. This should be left to the judges. Should be left to the court. The court should be given enough flexibility to use the rules of procedure in a way that is efficient and work. If you go into a system of rules which is too much analytical, too much full of obstacles, then you hinder the possibility of work. Maybe some responsibility have also the judges and the prosecutor in applying these rules and applying in a way that makes even more complicated the system. I don't exclude that, but it's certain that this micromanagement of the court by the Assembly of States Party is wrong. It's simply wrong. A court must have the flexibility of working efficiently and applying the rules in an efficient way. And, of course, one can devise other suggestions to improve. I don't have the list of the suggestions. But certainly, one could be to give more weight to customary law. I know one of the criticisms of the international justice is that the criminal law applied has been customary law. which is uncertain, which is difficult to assess, but the great results have been done on that and not in applying statutes. Nuremberg applied customary law. There was no statute. Somebody says they invented the law. Well, yes and no. It depends how you shape customary law. If it's just the conscience, the opinion of jurists, more than the practice, the Nuremberg is okay. I mean, it depends on the doctrines. But and the ICTY made all the progress on customary law and not in applying statutes, because it couldn't apply statutes, and the statute does not want to be applied as such, whereby. That doesn't mean that mistakes were not made, of course. But a decision based on customary law is universal. A decision based on a statute is not. And having a rule, applying strictly the rule of Article 21 of the ICC, which the court is doing, applying the statute, essentially, and not as appropriate customary law, invites states which are not parties to say this is res inter alios act. We are not parties, we are not interested in what they say. A decision based on customary law implies that states and courts of other countries will have to take into account. And I think this is very important. And has been a great success of the ICTY. How many cases? Look at the case law of states, for instance, like the United States. Look at the case law on the alien tort. How many cases mention decisions of the ICTY? Try to look at that and you will see it. What is the impact on the law at the domestic level? But that's because it's customary law which is applied, which is universal. If it were a treaty that's applied, states not parties would not take that into account. So I think this is also something that should be done. That can be done by the judges, in my view. That does not need to be done by a reform of the US. But there may be a number of other issues to be taken into account. I think the main problem is to give the court flexibility. Because otherwise, the procedure becomes too long, and the criticism of the court to the court made generally is that it's too long. There's not done enough. And of course, they compare with other tribunals, says, what has the ICTY done in 10 years? And what has the ICC done in 10 years? Is much less, inevitably. It's not even comparable. And I'm not saying the court should be criticized for that, but there must be the reasons why this happened, and one has to identify this reason and change something, and have the court work. I stop here. I think I spoke too long.
You did not. Thank you very much. Well, my main regret is that a number of diplomats and new judges on the court were not here to hear the remarks of our two panelists. But as I understand it, this will be preserved for history, and we will be sure to send copies of the video to people who should be forced at the point of a gavel to watch it. We're now at 7:20, and I think we are committed to end up by 8. Is that right, Diego? Or 7:30? Okay, I got two different notices: 7:30 and 8. We'll maybe go a little bit past 7:30, unless the landlord kicks us out. I was going to give our two pugilists time to duke it out between optimism and realism and skepticism, but I think the best way now, given the shortness of time, is let's take three questions. And I will invite then our two speakers to address the three questions or any of them as they wish. And in the course of doing so, Judge Steiner, if you wish to express any views on Judge Pokhar's intervention and vice versa, please feel free to do so. So, first question.
So, first of all,
and let me ask each person to. Oh, okay. Thank you for the mic.
To clarify for the scheduling, we'll do the Q&A until 7:30, and then we have a reception in the side room right here that we hope you'll attend.
And hopefully we can squeeze a little bit of time out of the reception for the Q&A. When you, by the way, when you intervene, please just give your name, and if there's a principal affiliation you wish to give, that's good too.
Okay.
I work for the U.S. Department of Justice, formerly at the ICTY and the ICC. First of all, thank you both for coming. It's really an honor to have you here. Judge Pokhar, I was very interested in your image of a final actor on the stage, and that final actor being the ICC. Now, I was wondering if we could push that image a little bit further and say, actually, there will be one actor on the stage, but there will be 193 audience members who will be domestic jurisdictions who are developing their rule of law, and also engaging in this process of extradition and mutual legal assistance on a bilateral, multilateral level. I was wondering if the two of you could speak to how you see the ICC within that fabric as time goes on, especially as countries are strengthening that system.
Great question. Next question. Yes, sir.
My name is Felipe. I'm part of the staff of the Academy of Human Rights. I'm from Colombia. Thank you both for coming. I would like to address two questions to Judge Steiner in particular. Last year, I believe, the general prosecutor from Ecuador, in the framework of the Union of South American Nations, UNASUR, proposed the idea of creating an international criminal court for South America. Kind of emulating the model that the ICC has. I wanted to ask you, as someone that comes from Latin America, what's your opinion on emulating the model of the ICC in South America? And the second question is, we all know that the ICC has a very specific catalog of crimes that they are prosecuting. We know that they prosecute genocide, war crimes, and crimes against humanity, but there's still an kind of blurry path regarding the crime of aggression that has still been decided and still hasn't come to like a clear definition of it. As a judge of the court, my question is, what do you think it will be the role of the court when that definition comes into light? How would the judges react towards prosecuting someone for a crime of aggression? Thank you so much.
Two excellent interventions. That puts the burden on our third intervener to ask yet another excellent question. You also need to raise your hand so we can tell.
Good afternoon. I'm Laura from Colombia. I'm a lawyer in Colombia and currently studying the summer course in American University. I want to ask two questions also. Following your thoughts about the blur version in the international community, I want to ask, what is your position about the international community transitioning from the tribunals ad hoc to a special courts, especially the case of Syria, Central African Republic? Is this a way to forget the mandate, the permanent mandate of the International Criminal Court, or you think it's really necessary to have a special court for these special cases in those countries? And my second question will be regarding to Central African Republic too. For Judge Steiner, how you think will be the dialogue or the collaboration between the ICC and the Special Court for Central African Republic in regarding that the ICC already have a situation in analysis about this country? Thank you so much.
You lived up to the test, Laura. Thank you very much. Judge Steiner, would you like to comment first?
My God, so many papers in front of me with so many things to be said. But I will try to behave. And so in relation to the first question put by the colleague from United States Justice. Yeah. I had already even made my comment exactly in that direction, that it's my view that the ICC plays an important role, and maybe the most important role is exactly the one of stimulating countries to implement the Rome Statute and to capacitate its judges and prosecutors and lawyers in order to be able to exercise their primary jurisdiction themselves. I think this is the future of international criminal law. Is international criminal law applied by national jurisdictions. The national jurisdiction is always the most convenient one. It's easier to collect evidence, it's easier the dialogue with the victims and with the witnesses, and the answer is much more visible by the population. So I think this in the future, I hope maybe not for my children, but for my grandchildren, that will be that every country will be able to try and to prosecute, investigate, prosecute and try their own criminals. So I think that the future, in the future, the ICC will be a real complementary court. Only in exceptional circumstances, the ICC will be called to intervene in a situation. In relation to my personal opinion for an ICC for South America, my first reaction would be, what for? I would prefer to have all South American countries being capacitated to try to investigate, prosecute, and try themselves those that are the most responsible for the crimes of international concern. I don't believe that one court is the solution. I believe the solution passes necessarily for the state's action and the state's effective prosecution of international crimes. How judges will react when finally the ICC is able to exercise its jurisdiction of the crime of aggression, I must confess I don't know the answer to give. I think there are still a long way to go until the moment that the court starts exercising jurisdiction, and I think that in the first cases it will not be an easy task, mainly because of the interrelation with the Security Council and with the powers of the Security Council. And it will be a very difficult situation having Security Council ensuring that there is not a situation of aggression and the prosecution saying, yes, there is. So the court will have to face these challenges, but I cannot anticipate. And finally, in relation to the questions put by the colleague from Colombia, I must confess, it's my fault, my ignorance. I was not aware of this proposal of creating a special court for Central African Republic. I work in a situation of Central African Republic, so it's really because I'm so concentrated in the deliberations in the Bemba decision, I had no time for following these developments. In relation to a special court for specific situations, I think as a provisional solution, they may help. For instance, in the case of Sierra Leone, it was necessary at that moment. But my expectation is, again, that in the future, these special courts will not be necessary anymore, because the states themselves will be capacitated to react to any situation that involves the commission of the most serious crimes. I hope I had answered to the questions without referring to any of the positions or the opinions given by Professor Pocar.
I believe Professor Pocar has judicial immunity in any event. Before I invite Judge Pocar to take us to our refreshments, just one informational point related to the last question about, or to the earlier question about a special criminal court for Latin America. As many of you may know, just about a year ago almost, the African Union adopted a protocol which has not yet entered into force, and the last time I checked, it had zero states parties, to create, but of course it's still early, so I don't know quite how to interpret that, to create a regional criminal court in the form of a criminal chamber to the African Court of Justice and Human Rights. Yeah. And with regard to the number of crimes, the protocol sets out a dozen or 15 crimes, international crimes, that can be prosecuted before that chamber if and when that protocol ever enters into force. So they go well beyond the short list of crimes that can be prosecuted before the ICC. Whether that comes into being or not, we shall see. Whether it might provide some sort of a model for Latin America is another question. And Judge Pocar, I apologize for delaying your intervention.
Thank you. You added this information that I already wanted to bring, but you did it. That's better. I will be short. I agree that the ideal situation is that states take care of these things. The crimes are international, but states and their jurisdiction can and must apply international law. I mean, this is something that is common agreement now of everybody, that domestic courts can apply international law and must apply international law when it's necessary. So the ideal situation certainly is there. But the fact is that states sometimes are not able to do that. That's a fact. Internal war, situations of disturbances that do not allow domestic jurisdiction to do the work, and do not allow, or corruption, number of situations that affect the ability of domestic courts to do that. So the ideal situation, going only to that, maybe a radical, maximalistic approach, which will lead nowhere. So I think one must be realistic that situation of this kind exists, and that the domestic level cannot do the work. So you have to go elsewhere. But, and of course you have an international court for that, for doing that. The regional courts. I accept the position that should be discouraged, but not totally. It depends how they are done. If the domestic regional courts are established as an alternative to the ICC, I would be against, in principle. But it's not obvious there should be an alternative. Because if a region takes care of the crimes in the region without disturbing the principle of complementarity, there should be these decisions should be as being common to the national level, but still subject to the principle of complementarity. I don't see any big issue, because it would be a mirror of the system of human rights, where you have regional approaches to human rights, and at the end it works better to have the two levels, the two possibilities. Why not in criminal law? Why should it? Before rejecting this possibility, I would consider it better. Because maybe having a common background, a region can deal with the cases better. Not necessarily in all cases the ideal international, but you have the ICC for that, in case to intervene if there is something wrong done at the regional level. But we should not forget that an international court like the ICC cannot do all the job. So the problem is where the rest of the job is done at the domestic level or is done also at the regional level. And I don't think that a regional cooperation should be necessarily wrong in that respect. Maybe successful, may work better than leaving only the domestic level. So it should be explored, this system and this possibility. I would not exclude it a priori. We should, and close on that, not forget also that the essential thing is not to defend court A, court B, court C, but is that the crimes that occur be prosecuted. That's the point. If international crimes are committed, be war crimes, crimes against humanity, genocide, tortures, gender crimes, or whatever, they should be prosecuted. That's the point. If it's court A or court B doing it, that's, again, a matter of structure. But the essential thing is the prosecution, is that it happens, that they are punished. And because the problem is impunity. And maybe there is not only one way to resolve the problem.
Judge Steiner has 1 minute for a final word here.
No, 5 seconds.
Was
just a comment, because in relation to these regional courts, and Professor Castle mentioned the African court that's has been already approved, but still depending on the statutes, etc. But the first draft statute provides explicitly for the immunity of the heads of states and high officials. So that's a big risk that we have regional courts that apply the law that they consider more convenient for the region.
But, and so what if there is the complementarity? They will not deal with the cases in which there are high levels, and that will be for the ICC.
Well,
it's very simple.
I think you'll all agree, we've had an illuminating discussion from people in a position to know and to whom we are indebted for a very educational evening. So please join me in giving a round of applause to our speakers.